Welcome everyone to our online service at Islington Baptist Church. And today I'll be singing a song called Mary Did You Know? But before I start, I would like to read from Luke 1:35. The word of the Lord says, "And the angel answered her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God, the Holy Son of God.'" Amen.
Good day, everyone. In our Christian calendar, today marks the beginning of the season of Advent, which we know to be a time of waiting, also a preparation for the celebration of the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and also a preparation for His second coming. Today, our Advent reflection is on hope. What do we hope for, and what causes us to hope? I hope that I will see my brother as soon as he can travel to Canada. I also hope that friends like Marvin, John, and Sarah, and many others will find work again so they can support their families. We hope that the coronavirus vaccine will be rolled out sooner than what has been announced. We also hope that there will be safe, clean drinking water for our indigenous communities as soon as possible. We hope that you and I can face each other again and gather together this Christmas time. Hope arises from emptiness. We hope for something that is absent, someone who is missing, or something that is lacking. True hope knows that there is something beautiful, something that is hidden that will emerge from our inconsolable longings. Our faith in God fuels our hope because we know that Christ has overcome sin and death for us. In his letter to the Romans, Paul writes, "Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. For all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who his children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of future glory, for we long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as his adopted children, including the new bodies he has promised us." Paul paints a world darkened by rebellion against God as he writes to a people who are estranged from God and living a hard life under an oppressive empire. It is a world no different from ours today that is dishonored by sin. Gripped by a pandemic that is unlike no other, it has changed how we live in such a short time and has caused nearly 1.5 million reported deaths worldwide. Sadly, still many falling ill and dying. There is also injustice of all kinds, hatred and violence. All of us are going through difficult time. Many are asking, where is God? Paul tells us that all this corruption that's going on outside and within us is nothing compared with the future glory that awaits us. You might find it strange that somehow creation knows that it will be delivered from darkness as it inches ever closer towards light, even though that light is flickering or trembling. We're also told that creation groans as in the just think of the miraculous pregnancies of Elizabeth and Mary. Elizabeth's dry and unfruitful womb was made fertile past her childbearing years to give birth to John the Baptist. And Mary, oh, such an innocent, young, unmarried woman favored by God, was conceived by the Holy Spirit to give birth to the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ. Eugene Peterson writes of Paul's letter to the Romans in language that sounds familiar. All around us, we observe a pregnant creation. The difficult times of pain throughout the world are simply birth pangs. But it's not only around us, it's within us. The Spirit of God is arousing us within. We're also feeling the birth pangs. This sterile and barren bodies of ours are yearning for full deliverance. That is why waiting does not diminish us. No more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We are enlarged in the waiting. We, of course, don't see what is enlarging us, but the longer we wait, the larger we become and the more joyful our expectancy. And so with great anticipation, we wait for that day. Children, flawed and imperfect beings as we are, will one day be made perfect and complete in God. On that day, God himself will publicly declare his very own in the fullness of his glory. So yes, in fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But for now, if we are to share his glory, we must also share in his suffering. Romans 8:17. We are saved by hope, and we must wait patiently. I close with the poetic words of Lois Schufert and pray, Lord, ready our hearts for the birth of Emmanuel. Ready our souls for the Prince of Peace. Heap the straw of our life for his body to lie on. Light the candle of hope and let the child come in. Alleluia.
Some announcements. We're continuing to collect offerings for special offerings for the orphanage in Honduras. And so if you're prepared and would like to do that, we'll be taking that collection up until the third week of December. Wednesday at 7 o'clock, our Zoom Bible study and prayer meeting get together for Wednesday. The links will be sent out. Andrew has also been leading a Bible study on Zoom for the young adults, and that continues this Wednesday at 7 p.m. We're in week number 5 of the ladies' Bible study, Get Out of Your Head, and so that continues. Thank you, Bev, for leading that. And we're going to ask that you would again read Romans chapter 4 to 6 this week. We've been walking a little bit slower through the book of Romans together. With the idea in mind that because there's so much content in the book of Romans that it just is going to take some more time for us to do that. And then next Sunday at 7 p.m. We'll have a short members meeting where we'll try to figure out a budget for next year. But why don't we just take a few minutes together to pray, and then let's dive into Romans 3 and 4 together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can gather together to collectively come to worship you. We thank you for taking us through another week, and we are just grateful that we have been called your ambassadors. We've been forgiven of our sins and have heaven as our home, and we pray that you would use us in this next week to encourage others to follow you, and that we ourselves would be strengthened in our commitment to you and in the call of holiness and righteousness. Thank you that you brought Lolita through her surgery. We pray she recovers, that you would strengthen her. We are also very thankful for how you blessed Marion with a good report from her medical exam that she had for Sue's dad, as he had eye surgery that went well. We thank you and praise you for these things. We pray for Jackson, who flew back yesterday to Brazil, as he gets settled in receive, that he would continue on in his walk with you, and that he'd be able, that you would lead him to a Bible church there, and that that would welcome him with open arms, and where he would be able to get involved. We think of Stephanie and Maggie as they are looking for work, as Stephanie rests from writing the big exam on Friday as part of her work application. We just pray you strengthen her this weekend. We think of Maggie as she starts a temporary job at Lush this week, that you would protect her and keep her safe there, and we thank you for your provision for her. We also think of Brian and Roseanne as they are in the process of moving out to Oshawa, and we thank you for them. We pray you bless them, and as they find a church family out there, a new church home, that you would even now prepare and open the door for them and where the place where they can serve and continue to serve you and with their family. We also think of our medical workers in our church who have been working extra hard this year. We think of the stressors, particularly Gloria, as she's on the COVID floor at the hospital. We thank you for her, and we pray you continue to protect her. We think of our other workers, not only in the medical system, but in the school. And Lord, we just think of we think of people looking forward to the good news of the vaccine, potentially later next year. But in the meantime, Lord, we are mindful that we're to first and foremost put our trust in you and be right with you. And so, and also also as we go about, as we're mindful of other people and their well-being, that, Lord, that you would find us as good citizens who are caring for others. We pray now you'd help us as we look into your word, and that your Holy Spirit would work in each of our hearts. We pray this in Christ's name. So let us take a look into the Bible together this morning, and we are going to be studying Romans 3. So for those of you online, grab your Bible. We're going to be digging into the thick of things in Romans chapter 3, 21 to 4, 25. And as we begin, just a little bit of the next slide, please, Em. Our focus this morning is, you can see on perhaps on this slide, salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. That's the consistent message of how does one come to have a right relationship with God. And Paul, in chapter 3, chapter 4, he talks about how Abraham came to be righteous in the sight of God, not by circumcision, not by law obedience, not by any other means or works, but he came into right relationship by faith. And it was by his faith that he was credited as righteous. And throughout the entirety of God's word, there is only one way anyone has ever come to be right with God, and it's by faith and the gift of God to the person who humbles themselves, repents of their sin, is the gift of righteousness, and it's ultimately found in Jesus Christ. Paul is writing the book of Romans as a bit of a background. He's not at the tail of the tail end of his third missionary journey. In the book of Romans, he expresses his desire to journey ultimately to Rome, to set up Rome as a sending church to further outreach areas. Spain particularly was one of the places that Paul wanted to go. And so he writes this book in anticipation of being able to do that and to go there. Now, this morning, as we look through the passage, we're gonna be introduced to some words that are not always on the tip of our tongues. Romans uses a lot of big words, in fact. It uses words such as justification, propitiation, redemption, righteousness, repentance. These are all foundational concepts and truths as it regards the gift of salvation and the grace of God in our lives. And so we're going to do a little bit of a crash course in getting our minds wrapped around what some of these big truths are all about this morning. But just before we go any further, let's have a look at the key verse, really. When we think about how is the book of Romans organized, it's organized around Romans chapter 1, verse 16 to 17. And it says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, and then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. These two verses form how the rest of the book is unpacked. And so it's just as we know that Acts chapter 1, verse 8 is the key verse of the book of Acts. So these are the two key verses of the book of Romans. Last week, and just a quick summary, last week we considered Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 3, verse 20, where Paul proved to us conclusively that we are all sinners, we are all unrighteous people, and then he makes the point very clear that apart from Christ, we in fact were far worse than we ever could imagine. And there's a vivid depiction of our unrighteous state before God, and yet it's all against the backdrop that despite our sinful condition, God is gracious, and he, in his great love, sent, while we were yet sinners, he sent Christ to die for us. And yet, the beauty of the cross is something that is only properly magnified, and the beauty of the work of Christ is something that's only properly understood when we understand exactly what our condition was apart from Jesus Christ. But today, we are going to go one step further, and we're going to take a look at Romans 3 to 4, and consider how it is faith, the centrality of faith, as it concerns coming to having a right relationship with the Lord, to being saved. Saved by faith. Saved by grace alone. That is at the the crux of what the gospel message is all about. So I'm going to invite you to turn with me, and we're going to read those verses together, and then we're going to unpack the text together. So let's jump in at verse 21 of chapter 3. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By the law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not the God of the Gentiles also? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Since God is one who will justify the uncircumcised by faith and the uncircumcised, justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. Chapter 4, which is part of the same unit of thought. What then shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the person against whom the Lord will not count his sin. Is his blessing only then for the circumcised or also for the uncircumcised? For we say that faith was counted to Abraham as righteousness. How then was it counted to him? Was it before or after he'd been circumcised? It was not after, but before he was circumcised. He received the sign of circumcision as a seal of the righteousness that he had by faith while he was still uncircumcised. The purpose was to make him the father of all who believe without being circumcised, so that righteousness would be counted to them as well, and to make him the father of the circumcised who are not merely circumcised, but who also walk in the footsteps of faith that our father Abraham had before he was circumcised. I think as we read, you probably get the idea of why we're going a little bit slower through the book of Romans. He says a lot in a short amount of time, and it makes our heads spin a little bit, but we're going to try to unpack it in a few moments together. We're almost done our reading. For the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs. If it is to be the adherents of the law who are to be heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. That is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. In hope, he believed against hope that he should become the father of many nations, as he'd been told, so shall your offspring be. And he did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead since he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the words it was counted to him were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead the Lord Jesus our Lord, who is delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. There's a lot of stuff in there. There's some amazing stuff that I want to take a few minutes to unpack with you. We're not going to be able to do it all, of course. But just as we dive in, it is helpful. When you read a book, sometimes you have a glossary, and the glossary gives terms and their meanings. Because especially when you read legal documents, you're like, I don't know what that means, and that means, and that means, and that means. And so you flip to the back, and you look through the glossary, and you're like, if I'm going to understand this document, I have to understand the words that are in the document. Well, the same thing comes when we study the Bible. There are going to be words that we don't use every day, which are really important, that we need to familiarize ourselves with if we're going to understand things. And this is the case in the book of Romans. Paul uses words such as righteousness, justification, substitution, redemption, propitiation, faith, repentance, grace. These are important terms as it relates to the gift of God and the salvation that we have in Christ. And so very quickly, to be righteous means to come to have right standing before God. It is to be regarded as holy and pure in the sight of God, to be acceptable to God, to have access to the presence of God, and such is only possible through faith. It's only possible through faith in Christ that one can a sinner can come to stand before a holy God and be accepted. It is ultimately has to do with the imputation of the righteousness of Christ to our account when we give ourselves in faith to Jesus. Justification is connected to righteousness. Justification, to be justified, is to be declared innocent. It's a legal term. To be declared to be free of guilt, to be clean and innocent in the sight of God. We are holy not because we've earned such status or somehow figured out how to avoid the sins of life. That's not why we're holy. We are holy in Christ because of the work of Jesus on the cross, because in Christ we've been blessed with the righteousness of Jesus. And God has made a legal declaration. You are free from guilt. On what basis? On the basis of the work of Christ on the cross. Substitution is critical to understanding the work of salvation. Substitution is basically instead of. And you know, instead of what? It says in Romans chapter 4, verse 25, that Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. When it says Jesus was delivered over to death, handed over to death, that's therein is the fundamental concept of substitution, instead of. You and I, the Bible says, the wages of sin is death. That's what we deserve. And to be separated eternally from God, and yet, because of the work of Christ, who stands in our place and takes what we deserve and the punishment of God on our behalf. And so substitution, redemption, is another big biblical term, and it has to do with being set free and there being a payment price. And ultimately, the Bible says that it's the shed blood of Jesus that was the price for our forgiveness, for our life, for our freedom from sin and bondage to Satan. The blood of Christ shed that we might be forgiven and have eternal life. The Bible is very clear, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And that it is the blood by the blood of Christ that we have been set free. And hence, when we think about why should I live a holy life today, we're reminded in 1 Corinthians 6 that we have been bought by a price, the shed blood of Jesus. And so as since we've been purchased by Jesus, we are to honor God with our bodies, it says in 1 Corinthians 6. Propitiation. Now, propitiation, in some of the newer translations, that word has disappeared and been replaced by the word atonement. Possibly because some people think it's an easier word to understand. And yet, propitiation is the proper term that is used in Romans chapter 3, verse 25. In the Greek, the word that's used there is halasterion. Halasterion has everything to do with the wrath and judgment of God. And something very important happened on the day of Christ. When, you know, in the Christ crucifixion says when the sky became supernaturally dark at midday, it's a biblical sign of the judgment of God. And we ask, well, who is experiencing the judgment of God? It's Christ taking the punishment we deserve for our sin. And so the word propitiation is an important term as it regards salvation, is that Jesus took the wrath and punishment you and I deserve that we might have eternal life and forgiveness. Faith, salvation is and always has been by faith. Faith is something that we must exercise. It's also a gift. God opens up our eyes to the Lord, and we respond in faith. But those two things go together. Faith, but always through the scriptures, saved by faith alone. How did Abraham come to be righteous in the sight of God? Not by works, but by faith. Repentance. That's another word that the Bible uses, and Paul uses in the book of Romans. What is to be our response to the declaration that we are sinners in the sight of God? The first response, it says, is we must repent of our sins. We are to say sorry to God. And a sorrow that is followed by a turning to Christ, who is the only Savior and Lord. And then in part of also repentance in our life is that resolving on our part said, I'm not going to go back to the sins that I was once committing. And sometimes you and I indeed do crawl back or run back, unfortunately, to sometimes the sins that we were committing. And that's why the Holy Spirit convicts us and says, what you're doing is wrong. And we need to say, God, I totally agree with you and I'm sorry. I know I'm supposed to be living a holy life. And so we turn with gratitude to God for his grace and his mercy that's found in the cross of Christ. And then grace, peace with God, ultimately, when we think about salvation, as we think about these key terms as it regards salvation, which Paul unpacks in great detail. I imagine they must have spent many, many days reading and rereading Paul's letter when they got it to say, okay, he's saying some really important stuff about how to understand faith. And so you and I, when we read during the week, read it, and then we got to come back to it. But understanding this is so important to getting a clear handle of what the work of God is. And grace is an undeserved and unearned gift as it regards you and I coming to knowing and having a saving faith. Now let's go on. Now we've got some of the foundational, we've looked in the glossary, we have an understanding of some of the important terms that Paul is using in the text and through the book of Romans. And I want us to drop down into chapter 4, and it really concerns the saving faith of Abraham, the father of all who believe, which is sometimes you and I can legitimately say as Christians that Abraham is our spiritual father. We exercise the same faith that Abraham set by example for us. And so Paul speaks to Jews and Gentiles, and he says, in Christ, Abraham is both your father. Now that would have been earth-shattering to long-standing Jewish people, because they're like, wait a second, that guy can't trace his genealogy to Abraham. How come you're saying that now they've been grafted in, and they're now calling Abraham their father as well? Paul says, absolutely. Because you're not saved based on your genealogy, you're saved by exercising the faith that Abraham had. And so he is regarded as the father of all who believe, of all who exercise this saving faith. And so when we think about the saving faith of Abraham, and Paul is making very clear this point, one comes to be righteous in the sight of God by faith alone. There's no other way to be saved than to put one's faith in Christ. And righteousness, right standing, it never rests upon our efforts. It always rests upon exercising faith, and that faith is in the person of Jesus Christ. Now, for the account of Abraham, in case you're not familiar with Abraham, Abraham is essentially the father of the Jewish nation. And all the way back in Genesis chapter 12, we're told that God One day when Abraham, who wasn't even named Abraham at that point, his name was Abram. Abram ironically means father. And it just so happens that when God called him at age 75, he was not a father. And yet his name, the first part of his name, is a reference to him being a dad. And then he's not a dad. And then later God changes his name to Abraham, which means he's going to be the father of many, which is a big leap when you have none. And so there's something there, and it shows you just how amazing God is at keeping his word and how God does it. But at age 75, the Lord appears to Abram and says, I want you to leave your country that you're in. He was living in modern-day Iraq. And God says, I want you to leave your family, and I want you to leave behind your parents and take your wife, and away you go to the place I'm going to show you. And it says, Abram obeyed God, and he went. And then when he shows up in the land, God's promise is, he said, I'm going to make you into a great nation, and one day all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. That's upon his arrival in the land. And then God also says, to your offspring I will give this land. And so there's an embedded in that a promise that Abraham's going to be a father, and yet he's 75 years old. And so you would think that, you know, God just told me that we're going to have a child. I'm 75, so that's got to happen right away. Didn't happen right away. In fact, when Abraham, some years later, God, in Genesis 15, he then again appears to Abram again and says, because Abram has a servant, and he's thinking, you know what? I still don't have a child. I don't know what's going on here. And he's thinking that his servant is going to become the heir of everything that he has. And at this point, as he's pondering these thoughts, it says the Lord appears in Genesis 15 to Abram and says, this man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. And then the Lord took Abram outside and he said, look up at the sky and count the stars if you can count them. And he says, that's how many your offspring are going to be. Now, I don't know about you, but age 75, a bunch of years go by, you're like, I don't know how much longer I have on the planet. I need to get my will in order. I know God made this promise, but I just don't see how that's going to happen. Maybe like Bob is going to inherit everything. And God hears all this and says, hey, by the way, Bob is not going to inherit everything. Have a look up in the stars. That's how many I'm going to give you a son. And then here's how, in the light of all that, here's how Abram responds. And it's really, this is what Paul's point is. How does one come to be right with God? It's by faith. It says, after the Lord said this to Abram, it says, Abram believed the Lord, and the God credited it to him as righteousness. In the face of all those years of waiting, despite the fact his body is old and worn out, despite that his wife Sarah is unable to have children, Abram says, God, I believe you. I believe you from the bottom of my heart. And because of that, God said, I'm going to give you an unexpected gift. That is the faith you have is a saving faith, that you trust me so deeply. That you have purposed in your heart that you will take me at my word and believe. And says, in response to this, God credits to Abraham that act as an act of righteousness. And that's the amazing gift of God in response to Abram's faith. Now, as we dive a little bit deeper and we think about Abram's faith, his was a saving faith. Salvation is and always has been. You're one slide ahead, Em. Salvation is and always has been by faith. It's the means by which one receives the promises of God. Abraham, his faith was not a static thing. It was not merely a profession. You and I would think about walking by faith. It's something that it's active and living. We just don't say, I have faith, and then carry on as if God doesn't exist. We say, I believe God, and I'm going to wait upon God, and I'm going to pray. Obviously, there's steps we take practically day to day, but ultimately we're not trusting in ourselves, we're not trusting in our abilities, we're trusting in God and we're believing in God. Faith is something that God rewards. He rewarded Abraham's faith. Along the way, God sent some things that assured Abraham of his faith. And God does the very same thing for us. One of the reasons it's so vital that for you and I to keep at times a record of answered prayer is because often, especially during crisis, we forget all the good things. And yet sometimes when we look and we're like, wait a second, I prayed about that. And I saw this happen in someone else's life. God really does truly send little signs along the way, reminding us that we're in his hands and he's on the throne and he hears prayer. And yet sometimes during the moment we lose sight of all that. And yet he sent assuring signs to Abraham along the way. One of the best definitions when we think about the subject of faith is faith, Hebrews 11 verses 1 and 2, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. And so the other example of faith is Abraham is not the only person listed in our passage as one exercising faith. He also references the fact that David, his experience with God, was the same as it was with Abram. As God credited to him his righteousness by his faith, he also references in verse 6 to 8, just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed is the one against whom the Lord will not count their sin. That's the blessing of putting one's faith in God. What is the end result? The taking away of our sins. And how is that done? It was made for by the work of Christ on the cross, ultimately. Now, the other thing about faith is I would encourage you, and have a look with me. There's a beautiful, beautiful verses, and you might still even be sticking in your mind. When we think about faith, faith is something that we need to cling to. It's something that we need to hold on to. It's something that we need to really, for lack of better words, fight for sometimes. And Abram did that as well. It says, look at verse 18. I find verse 18 through the end really inspirational. It speaks about Abraham. It says, in hope, he believed against hope. That he should become the father of many nations as he'd been told, so shall your offspring be. Now I find that inspiring when I look against all hope, Abraham in hope believed. Things were stacked up on the physical level. It seems that everything is stacked against God's word coming to pass. God says, look at the stars in the sky. That's how many descendants you're going to have. Abram's like, I don't have any kids. I'm old. Physically, my body is just not capable anymore. And neither is my wife, by the way. But Abraham didn't put all these objections up. You and I are the ones that put all those objections up. Other people would have been throwing that in the face of Abraham. And yet Abraham, it says, he actually believed God. He didn't go the objection route. He actually said, God, I believe you. That's hope. That's believing God. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed. He took God at his word and said, I don't know how you're going to do this, but I believe that you're able to do it and that you will do it. Despite my circumstances, I am going to believe you. And it says in there, as we continue on, it says in verse 19, he did not weaken in his faith when he considered his own body. You know, sometimes you and I look at our circumstances and you're like, God's made these promises, but my bank account is empty. My health is failing. My family life is spinning out of control right now. I just lost my job. How can I trust God? And yet, what does it say about Abraham? He says he did not weaken in his faith when he considered, he wasn't blind to the fact that his body was old. And yet he still said, I believe God. And that's the kind of faith that we are challenged to say, You know, that's what faith is. Faith is taking God at his word and believing, even though there's sometimes lies in our head which not our minds. Sometimes people around us will say, well, look at your world, it's falling apart. Why are you still following God? And it says, Abraham in hope believed against hope. That's tenacity. That's real faith. Is to say, I don't care what it looks like around me, I'm holding on to God's word because it's true and nothing will change my mind. I'm going to persevere in my faith. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the words that was counted to him were not just written for his sake, but also for ours. And it will be counted to us who believe in him, who raised from the dead the Lord Jesus our Lord, who is delivered up for our trespass and raised for our justification. To steal a psalm title when we think about faith, don't stop believing. I can't remember what decade there was that song came out, REO Speedwagon or something, I don't know. But that's the thing. You and I, don't stop believing. Again, hoping against all hope, in hope he believes. And it's not a blindness where he's like, my situation's perfect, I can see how all the ducks are lining up. No, he said, yeah, I know what my situation is, but I trust God. And I'm not stopping in my faith. That's why it says, that is why God credited it to Abraham as righteousness. Because he had that kind of faith, and that I find that inspiring. So, if you wanna get a Bible verse, grab a hold of verse 18. In hope, he believed against all hope. Now, the last point when we think about this, and kind of a little bit of a reversal in our text, but it's important because ultimately, when we're talking about Romans chapter 3 and 4, we're talking about saving faith. How does one come to have righteous standing before God? It's by faith. And by faith alone. And sometimes people rely on the wrong things, and Paul highlights that in the passage. Go ahead, Emily. Paul, when he talks about Abram, there's three errors that the Jews of Paul's day, the unbelieving Jews of Paul's day, had as it regarded salvation. Paul's unbelieving Jewish brethren mistakenly thought, erroneously thought, that genetically being related to Abraham made them automatically the children of God. They thought that, hey, I can trace my lineage back to Abram. So all the promises God made to Abram are automatically mine no matter what. And to counter this, John the Baptist himself encountered this when he was preaching, and he had a word to the Jewish people that came to him. He said, don't say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. And Paul, in the passage, he points out that, you know, Abraham, his salvation, his right standing, had nothing to do with genetics. Had everything to do with faith. And the unbelieving Jews that were hearers of Paul, they were counting on their genetic lineage. And Paul says, don't count on your genetic lineage. Just as today, our children aren't saved if we have children. They're not saved because they're related to us. They have to exercise their faith in Christ personally. They need to repent of their sins personally and come to Christ. And that's our prayer. The second thing, the error of the unbelieving Jews, was that they thought that being circumcised. Paul talked about circumcision in the passage. They said, okay, the mark of salvation of being right with God is if as a male that you were circumcised on the eighth day. And Paul says, guess what? God credited it to Abraham as being righteous before he was circumcised. And so how in the world can you say that circumcision is the means of salvation when God saved Abraham wasn't circumcised until quite a while after his coming into relationship with God as a sign, as a symbol of being set apart by God, but his salvation had already happened prior to that. The third stubbornness, aspect of stubbornness as it regards how to have a right relationship with God, the unbelieving Jews of Paul's day, they stubbornly held on to the false thought that that obeying the law was the key to being saved. And Paul says, actually, the law is not going to save you. The law condemns you. The law, in fact, increases your awareness of sin because you realize, oh, I've broken actually 10 out of 10 of God's commandments. That's not a good thing. And actually, when you and I, the Ten Commandments is so vital for us because it proves that we're sinners. Not only does it prove we're sinners, it also shows how holy God is. It also provides for us a standard for how we're to live our lives as the followers of Jesus Christ. But the law in itself, it convicts us straight up, but it doesn't leave us there. That's the beauty of Christ, is it takes us to the one who perfectly kept the law, and then who died as a substitute, as a once-for-all sacrifice for our sins. And so the law, its purpose is to actually lead us to Christ, because it can't save us. It is perfect, and it is holy, but it cannot save. It is Jesus alone who saves, and it's by faith in Christ alone who saves. So in this argument that Paul writes, he's talking about saving faith. He's talking about the saving faith that Abraham had. And for all those who idolized Abraham, he said, your being related to Abraham is not going to save you. Your being circumcised as Abraham was is not going to save you. Your trying to obey the law is not going to save you. In fact, the law hadn't even been given in the day of Abraham. It wasn't until Moses that God gave the law. And so he destroys their arguments about as it regards the way of salvation, all the while making it so crystal clear, salvation is by faith alone. And saved by faith, saved by the grace of God alone. And then we have to be careful when we think about it is, you know, there's people make similar errors today about the way of salvation. We'll bump into people that talk about just being sincere. Pick a path, pick a spiritual path, and just be sincere. That's all that's required. Or maybe just try to do enough good deeds, and that's enough to get God's attention to warrant you're going to heaven. Often funerals will talk about, even unbelievers will talk about, you know, grandma or dad or mom or brother or sister, they're in heaven now. So despite people's unbelief about God, is somehow buried in their mind is still a concept of heaven. And alongside of it is all this baggage about how do you get there. And generally speaking, it's if I'm just a good person and because God's like a big granddad in heaven. Who just overlooks everything that people do. And yet God is holy and God is just. And when we look at the way of salvation, it is so crystal clear we're far worse than we ever thought we were. And yet despite our sinfulness, the love of God is magnified while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. And so Paul, as we conclude this, is there is only one way to be righteous in the sight of God. There's only one way of salvation. It's by faith. It's by faith in Christ alone. And so if you want to be right with your Creator, put your faith in Jesus. If you want to be forgiven of your sins, put your faith in Jesus. If you want to be reckoned as righteous in the sight of God, put your faith in Jesus. If you want heaven as your home, put your faith in Jesus. If you want to be able to confidently face the coming day of judgment, put your faith in Jesus who took the punishment that we deserve. And then perhaps, maybe even if you're watching, if you haven't put your faith in Jesus, there is the call to be reconciled to God. And the gift of God to all who would believe is eternal life. And that eternal life and forgiveness is found in one person alone. It's found in Jesus Christ. That's how amazing God's love is, particularly when we understand what was my condition apart from Christ. And then crystal clear, you need to exercise the same faith that Abraham had. We need to believe God. And when God says Jesus is in salvation is found in no one else, we're to say, I believe that. Jesus is the only way to be saved. Let's pray as we close. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. And Lord, your word in the book of Romans is undoubtedly complex. And so we pray as we continue to read it this week, that your Holy Spirit would stir in our hearts, that you would help us to understand it and apply it right. But we thank you for the crystal clear message that there is salvation found in no one else than other than Jesus Christ. And so we pray you find us, for those that don't know you, we pray that they would be drawn to your presence in repentance and faith. We also pray for ourselves that we continue to be found following you from our hearts. And as we think about sometimes the adversities of life, we think of Abraham, who, hoping against hope, not stopping to believe, saying, doesn't matter what my external circumstances are, I'm going to believe you, God. Help us to be like that, Lord. We praise in Jesus' name. Amen.